crores, which everybody knows it. PAN allotted this data is up to 30 June, because 31st March 2028 the data is yet to be released, but almost around 43.52 lakh crores PAN has been allotted to the individuals. That is individuals' data, among which 9.26 crore people are registered users on the income tax website, that is registered on the ITD website. Individual returns, almost around 6.44 crores returns have been filed by individuals. That is, if you see the population against 134 crores, 43.52 crores PAN and 6.44 crores return filers. And out of this, 60% return filers are ITR, there is ITR 4 and ITR 1, that's reserved to taxation. Aadhaar holders, almost around 122 crores, out of which 35 crores people have been covered by insurance. And mutual fund investor, almost around 2 crores. And bank account holders, almost around 75 crores. So this is the statistical information. Comparatively, this each year the income tax returns filing has been increasing. But if you see the data of 2018-19 comparative with 2019-20, there is only 1% increase in the returns filing. Aadhaar linking, linking of Aadhaar with PAN deadlines have been increased. But this year, there are no changes in the number of forms. Number of the forms remains the same. Then, basically the reasons for the change is because the department is moving towards, the department is, the main purpose of the income tax department is to strike on the tax evasion and ensure that the all the returns which are filed, or the people who are filing the returns, are filing the correct returns or returns and time returns. Then identification of the ghost directors and the shell companies, investment in unlisted companies, details capturing, because these are the major areas where the defaults are happening. So the reason behind the changes in this form is to curb this type of loopholes which are there. Then check on the salaried income deductions which are claimed as an exemptions by the employees, because now you see the form 24 TDS return also has been modified. It is now form number 24Q requires additional information to be given because from all the salaried employees. To check the revenue leakages which are there, especially in case of capital gains and immovable property, wherein the people are selling the property and they're selling the property and hiding the capital gains. And there are revenue leakages in capital gains also. You might be knowing that last 2 or 3 years, the cases of related to penny stocks and other related items which are pending in litigation, that has been one of the reasons for modification of this years of the returns, and they have captured this information to ensure that there is no such capital gains evasion. And the income tax department software, which has been introduced now, it captures information from all areas, where right from income which has been parked out of the country, then data sharing across the globe with all the countries, because now all the information is being shared with across the globe with all the countries, and being due to exchange of information, the government is receiving the information from various sources, and the software now verifies whether whatever the information which has been received here has been captured or it been mentioned or informed in the return of income and the proper tax has been paid or not. Then the main intention here of the government is to boost returns. The filing of returns, though it has increased, the new return filers have increased from after the demonetization period. But if you see, the tax collection has not grown that much till now. The revenue growth till March 2020, I mean, the corporate tax was around 14% and personal IT rail around 13.3%. The problem, which are the issues which has been faced here by the government, is filers and the stop filers have increased. So the people who are holding the PAN, they have stopped filing the returns. Many of the people who are holding the PAN, for some or the other reasons, the returns filing has not been there. Either the SSC may have expired, or they may have left the country, or whatever may be the reasons, this is remaining. This is the biggest challenge for the government. 20.4 million are the non-filers are there between 2013 to 2017, which is the source derived information derived from NMS. Non-filers also includes the drop filers. That is, they have stopped filing the return of income. The periodical review of exemptions, deductions, tax incentives also one of the reasons wherein the issue of the because the returns filing has been dropped. Because what happens when the income falls below the taxable limit? The people stop filing the return of income. And for to check this, the prosecutions has been launched for the willful tax evaders, and there has been the provisions which has been enabled in the Finance Act, through the Finance Act, and wherein now if there is a huge tax liability, the prosecution actions are also being taken. And lastly, but not the least, that is social and the natural calamities. You know, this year also we are facing this COVID pandemic, and because of this, the last date of return of income, which was there on 31st of March 2020, has been extended to 30th June last, and now further it is extended to 31st of July. Based on this also, there is a delay in filing of return of income. So IPR forms, which has been notified on May 29 to 2020 by wide notification number 330AB, there are no changes in the numbers of form. But now there's a bigger change, that is now return of income can be filed by using either PAN or Aadhaar. This is a significant change. So what happens here now, Aadhaar card automatically becomes your PAN number. So here what the department has come up with, that if you have Aadhaar and if you don't have PAN, then also instant PAN can be allotted through Aadhaar within seconds. So that also if a facility has been enabled in on the income tax website, that is, it is available on the income tax ITD website or the income tax India efiling.gov.in. And whatever the returns filing through Aadhaar will be done. The rule says that the PAN will be automatically allotted to such type of cases. But here the biggest problem is the website is not yet enabled to ensure that the returns can be filed through Aadhaar, because user ID which is required is the PAN number. Without PAN number, you cannot file the return. So how this is going to work, time will only say. ITR 2 to ITR 4 can be filed by using PAN or other. Basically, it is only for the individual SSCs. No other SSCs can file ITR with Aadhaar. Then there is a mandatory filing exceeding specified limits of cash deposit, foreign travel or electricity expenses. This is one of the area where the filing, because even if you don't have the taxable income, but you have incurred your deposit cash exceeding rupees 1 crore in your current bank account, or you have done any prior foreign travel and spent amount exceeding rupees 2 lakhs, or you have spent any electricity expenses exceeding 1 lakh, though your income is below the taxable limit, you are mandatorily required to file the return of income. Time limit for claiming the exemptions for investment under Chapter 6, the last date it was June 30th, now but it is extended. Was this presentation was prepared 3 to 4 days back, so at that time the date was 30th June, so it says that. Utility of ITR 2 and ITR 4 has been released for e-filing, and ITR 2 is also enabled for filing, but it will be available from Monday onwards. So from Monday onwards, you will be able to upload ITR 2 also. Due dates as of now, that is in 30th November for individual firms partner which are not liable for audit. That is as per the extended notice, this amendment. Submission of tax audit report under Section 44AB, that is 31st of October. So here now, this is also one of the biggest change which has been taken, which has been there for this financial year. That is the tax audit report date and the returns filing date, there is a difference of 1 month. 1 month time limit has been given. The basic reason here for giving this time limit is that the department is planning to give the pre-filled utility to all the people who are filing the returns. So pre-filled, all the information which is given or submitted in the tax audit report will automatically be captured in the ITR, because this is one of the reasons where the processing is slow. You might be getting the notices for difference in the return which is filed and what is reported in the tax audit report. The notices are coming and the returns are not being processed because of this due default. Now we have requested them that wherever there is such type of any report or any qualification which is there by the tax auditor and which is not accepted by the SSC. So in filing the return of income at that time, you at least provide some fields wherein the clarifications can be given, because basically what happens that when this area where this clarification is not available, it is not possible. Some qualifications are given and some explanatory notes are being given, which are also captured by the system at the time of processing of return of income. But these are just only a clarificatory notes and which do not have any effect on the taxable income. So that such type of returns are being kept on hold for processing. So we have asked for it. Let us see now how the department is going to take care of it and how it is going to work it out. Then 30th November, there is for the company's SSCs covered under the audits, working partners of the firm, etc. So again, for them now, all the date of the total there is the last date for filing all type of returns is now 30th of November. Whether you are covered by audit, you are covered by transfer pricing, etc. Everything. So the 30th November is the due date as of now, until and unless it is further extended or thereafter. So higher detailed. Now reporting in the IDR form itself, the government is approaching toward the transparency, that is wants that all information should be available and the people should declare whatever they have it in the return of income. The area of e-assessment has started, that is there is a minimum manual interaction between the SSC and the assessing officer, and this COVID-19 has made everything on a virtual mode, like our study circle meeting also. So basically, so virtual things are increasing now, and there is a faceless assessment which is there. So in the return of income, all the information which is required for the purpose of assessment are being captured by the system. And there is again a change in form 26AS also. That is AIR information is now being reported. That is whatever the information is collected will now be reported in the AIR, which will be covering at the end of the session, last session in more in detail we'll cover it. Then the taxpayer's base will automatically expand as a result of this. Linkage with all the revenue department. Now this is again a biggest problem, that is now the information which is provided in the return of income is now being extended to, is been cross-verified or cross-checked with all the types of return of income. This whatever information are giving it in the return of income, like GST figures. Now GST figures, what you are giving it at, in the is being compared with the figures which are given submitted in the GST field along with the figures which are given in the profit and loss field. Now there are also some of the issues are there, because what happens under the GST Act, when there is a branch transfer, that is when you transfer from one branch to another, it is treated as turnover of this branch, and the system except in GST returns, it becomes a turnover, whereas in ITR, it doesn't form a part of the turnover. So such type of differences are being there. So, and for reporting such type of difference, there is no field which is available. So, and as a result of this, the defaults are being generated by the system. So yesterday only I was just trying it, working on one ITR. So it gave me the difference that the difference was because of the figures which are reported in the GSTR is not matching with the profit and loss account. So the validation error it created. So basically what had happened that I have reported a profit and loss account, I have one figure, and I have the SSC was having income from rent. So income from rent is basically taxable as income from house property, it is not reported in the profit and loss account. So such type of variances are there. These type of variances are resulting in defaults. So this type of information is required to be, so representation is required to be made that how this system is going to work, because there should be some facility or some columns which should be available in the ITR itself, that wherein the SSC is able to report why there is a difference and what is the reason of the difference, and it should enable the SSC to validate the file and upload the return of income. So this year only one category of persons are exempted from e-filing, that is a person who is a super senior citizen who should not have any profit and gains of business or profession. Then only he can file the return online. Otherwise, everybody, that is all type of SSCs are required to file the or upload the return online within the specified time limit. Only these are there exempted people. So this is one of the maybe I got it and I thought it was worth sharing with you. So there is the new form has come. So let us not lose the temper this time, because whenever the new forms are introduced, our temper starts increasing, because whatever the information is required to be reported is much, much, much in detail. So this is just for a sharing outside. Now, who can file the ITR returns? There is no change in the people who are required to file the returns of income. That is, it remains the same as of the last year. Only one category here is added. That is the joint. Till last year, the joint holders were not allowed to meet. To if the a property was held in joint name, then these type of people, even though they qualified to file ITR one, they were not eligible to file ITR one. So now here, this amendment has been made this year, so that if the even in case of joint holders, if they have income from only one property, then and your income is below 50 lakh rupees, 50 lakh rupees, then you can file use ITR one. So these are the basically the where who can use it. Those who cannot use the ITR one form, that is, there is no change in that. So I'm not wasting much of the time in discussing this type of return. Second ITR is ITR two. It is for the individuals. That is, ITR one is applicable only for resident individuals, whereas ITR two is for individuals or HO who are not having income from business or profession who are not eligible to file ITR one. ITR 3 is for individuals and HUF who are having income from proprietary business or profession. Now, what happens here is that if you are eligible to file ITR 1 and if you want to file ITR 3, you can file ITR 3. There is no such mandatory that if you are eligible to file ITR 1, you cannot use ITR 3. You can use the higher version of return of income. The basic advantage here is that when you are using the higher version of return of income, if you want that here, the disadvantage here is that you have to give the additional information which will not be asked by the ITR 1 or ITR 4, whatever the returns which you are or which you are eligible to file it. Now, if you are choosing to file ITR 3, then you will have to give additional whatever the additional information which is required for validation of returns. It is mandatory. You cannot skip that information. Secondly, whenever you want to, if you have missed, skipped some income, or if you want to file the revised return, and at that time, the income may be from the profit or gains of business, but since you have used ITR 1 and now you want to shift to ITR 3, the system won't permit you to change the ITR version. So if you are ITR, if you have filed ITR 3 and if you want to revise the return of income, then you can definitely revise it. But if you want to file, if you already filed ITR 1 and you want to file ITR 3 revised return, then the system is not permitting, it will not be accepted by the system. Then ITR 4 again is the simplest return, that is for presumptive type of income. Again, here also one change which is there this year, that is, this return was also not eligible to be those who were holding the property in jointly. They were not allowed to file this return, but now this type of people can, joint holders can use this ITR, provided they have, they qualify with the other criteria which are applicable for these returns. Again, the time, aggregate income limit here is 50 lakhs. So if you have 50 lakhs income which is exceeding 50 lakhs, you cannot use ITR 4, you have to shift to ITR 3. So basically, all this, I think this is does not require much more discussion because there is no change in the criteria for filing whatever the discussion. Which have deductions under section exempt income under section 11. ITR 6 is basically for the companies that is claiming exemption other than the companies which are claiming exemption under section 11. So section 8 companies or the earlier section 25 companies as per the 1956 Act, those who are taking the benefit of section 11, then they cannot use ITR 6. They have to use ITR 7. ITR 7. But if they use ITR 6, then they're claiming the deduction under section 11 will not be allowed to such type of access. Then ITR 7 is the last return, that is charitable trust association who are claiming the benefit of exemption under section 11 for companies, that is political parties, etc. There's no change in this. It remains the same. ITR 7 for the trust or the those who are mandatory required to be filed, they are required to file. Political parties are required to file mandatorily return with digital signature, that is mandated. Now coming to the general changes, what changes are there? Almost there are 10 changes, basic changes in the ITR, which we'll be taking first one by one. So Finance Act 2019 introduced mandatory filing, that is seven provisions was amended, which made it mandatory filing to all such type of SSCs, that is cash deposit in current account, expenditure in foreign travel, expenditure in consumption of electricity. So all ITR up to 1 to 4, if they have incurred any such expenses, then they are required to file the return. So here the option has been there in part A, general information. So if you are filing the return of income, under the seven provisions of section 139(1), but otherwise you are not required to furnish any ticks, yes. So basically here what it says that if you are a regular SSC and you are filing the return of income, then this is not required to be, this field is not required to be checked, because here you are not mandated to file the return because of this seven provision. You are regular filers, you are having the taxable income, etc., etc. Then you have to select, you have to select here no. So if you select as yes over here, all other fields will automatically get activated and you will have to select the information yes or no. Now what it requires here is, have you deposited amount which is in aggregate of exceeding 1 crore in one or more current account during the previous year? If you select here yes, then you have to specify the amount which has been deposited. If you have income, you have incurred any expenditure in aggregate exceeding rupees 2 lakhs for travel in a foreign country for yourself or for any other person. If it is yes, then you have to specify the amount. Now here what it says that you have spent the money. That the person who has spent the money, whether he has traveled or he has not traveled, that is a separate question. So if he has spent the money for himself or any other person, then he has to report. So according to me, the person who has traveled but who has not spent the money, he doesn't have to report, because here it says the section says whatever the requirement here is, it is by the person who has spent the money and not the person who has actually traveled. Then, have you incurred the expenditure of an amount or aggregate exceeding rupees 1 lakh or the consumption of electricity during the previous year, financial year? So if yes, then you have to specify the amount. Again, here also the clarification is required to be done, whether it is for the purpose of business or it is for the purpose of personal expenses. So this is not given. So basically the clarification here needs to be sought from the department. Basically, what is the intention, whether they want the information for personal purposes or for the business purposes also has to be included. So that clarification has been sought. For let us wait for the notification to come. And this is one first change. Second change is about the general information in ITR 3 and ITR 5. That is basically individual actuaries and all. The tax audit limit, which has been now modified, that is if a person is having by Finance Act 2020 has made it applicable from 1st April 2020 or not. So it is applicable from assessment year 2021. So assessment year 2021, if you are declaring income under section 44AB, that is presumptive income section, then whether your sales or turnover is exceeding rupees 1 crore but does not exceed 5 crores. Because if your turnover is below 5 crores and you're spending, or your cash transactions, receipt of loans like capital contribution, etc., etc., does not exceed the 5% of the turnover amount, then your tax audit, this turnover limit, you can go for presumptive. You can opt for presumptive and you can report this. You can report this will not be covered by the tax audit. Not be covered for the tax audit. So if it is yes, then all the payment incurred for the capital expenditure amount, etc., repayment of loans. So it says that sales, turnover or gross receipts or capital account like capital contributions, loans, etc. during the previous year in cash does not exceed 5% of the same amount. So if it does not exceed, yes. If yes is selected, then you will have to inform whether aggregate of all payments made including incurred. So here it says that receipts and payments on capital amount exceeding cash does not exceed 5% of the said payment. So here any one of the criteria, if it is satisfied, if it is no, then your tax audit limit will be 1 crore and not 5 crores. So if you are liable for tax audit 44AB, then automatically other field will get activated. Another change which has happened here for reporting is that earlier the tax auditor's permanent account number was required to be given. Now the Aadhaar number can also be given. So either you can give PAN number or you can give Aadhaar number, or the tax auditor's Aadhaar number can be given in place of PAN number. So wherever in all the cases, all the fields wherein PAN number was required to be given, now has been the option has been given that either you report the PAN number or report the Aadhaar number. Then income from salary, that is ITR 1 and ITR 2, the nature of employment now requires, this option has been given that while selecting this in the general information, the nature of employment, the option has been given whether you are a part of central government, state government, public sector, pensioners, etc., which was not there earlier. The others, it was only the others field which was there, and not applicable field was not available. Now this not applicable field has been added this year. So if we have the nature of applicants, so if the employee does not fall in any of the category, the not applicable field was required, is required to be selected. Otherwise, previously, in the previous year, it was only others it was required to be given. And here, if the requirement is written is filed on account of any notices which has been received, then UDIN number is being mandated. So without UDIN number, you cannot file the return of income. That is, UDIN number is mandatory. Why? Because now any correspondence which is received from the income tax department must should be UDIN generated. So when any UDIN is generated, the necessary to notice the number, when it is mentioned here, it automatically reconciles with the notices which has been issued, and the system keeps the track of the filers due to this such notices. Then changes in the income from house property. Again, if your house is the letter for house is let out to any individual, and the person does not have the person that is the person to whom you have leased the house doesn't have PAN number, then Aadhaar number of the tenant can be given. So that is also has been, so this field has been activated. So either you can give Aadhaar number or you can give PAN number of the tenant. So these changes are made in all IPR. Capital gains reporting, there is additional reporting for sale of shares. Now if you see the full field, new field has been added. The first part, that is section 112A, is for the resident SSCs, and second part, that is 115AB, which is applicable for non-resident SSCs. So whenever you are claiming any long-term capital gains here, you have to give the full details, which is ISIN code number is mandatory. So ISIN code, name of the share unit, that is number of the share unit, etc. Sale price per unit has to be given, full value of the consideration has to be given, cost of acquisition without indexation, cost of again with indexation. If there is, then automatically it will compute whatever your cost is there, because 1st February 2018 is the cutoff date wherein for the price whichever was higher, that is cost of acquisition or the price which was there on 1st February 2018 will be treated as your cost fair market value, and accordingly the capital gains will be worked out. So if it is a long term capital gains, then ISIN code is mandatory. So here you have to be very specific here, because without ISIN code the return is not getting validated. So ISIN code and this information, basically what happens, the annual, this AIR information, that is stock exchange stock brokers are also required. This information is collected by the department from the stock exchanges from time to time by AIR information. And what is reported here is that department is going to provide the prefilled utility of such type of transaction, which will be actually captured by the system. Now let us wait and see at what time they are going to provide with such prefilled utility, because ITR 2 is getting enabled tomorrow onwards, that is from Monday onwards. So let us see whether they are going to give this utility which is prefilled or not. Otherwise it will be very difficult task to capture all this type of details when details are in numerous for those who are dealing in having income from capital gains in case of sales of shares and all. Similar type of information for the same has to be given by the non-residents also, the SSCs, for claiming as a exemption. So this is on the similar lines also. So same information is there, but it has to be ensured that if the person is a non-resident, then it has to be reported in 115AD. If a person is a resident, then he has to report in 112A. And any misreporting will result in differential tax liability, because what happens there, the status of the SSC is selected in the general information. Then capital gains of property, again here, in case of any sale of immovable property. So if any person who has purchased the immovable property or the PAN number, the person, the name of the buyer has to be given, the PAN number of the buyer was required to be given, but here now if the person does not have PAN, Aadhaar number of the buyer has to be given. So slowly and gradually what we are moving in, we are moving towards one unique identity number wherein either PAN or Aadhaar. Basically department is trying, the government is trying to ensure that all the PANs are linked with Aadhaar, but slowly and gradually many of the Aadhaars are not yet linked yet. So here basically when the Aadhaar number will be given, automatically the PAN and Aadhaar may be linked if the PAN is provided. So here the Aadhaar number can be given, either PAN or Aadhaar can be given to for the buyer. IDR 3, 5, and 6, basically 43B section was amended last year. That is now any interest or loan on MDVS, if it is not paid within the specified time limit, becomes a disallowance under section 43B. So that type of any disallowance is now, it is there. So here you have to give the classification has to be given, basically what is given in the tax audit report. So if the tax audit report, in tax audit report, if any of these sums which are disallowed, same has to be reported here in the specified clause which is provided. So it has to match with the tax audit report details. And if you know that from 1st of November last year, there was additional depreciation which was granted to for purchase of motor vehicles and motor cars, that 15% additional depreciation was given to such type of those who have purchased a car after specified date. So they are entitled to 15% additional depreciation. So 30 plus 50, 45% depreciation has provided here. So that is 15 plus 15, 30%, and for motor lorries, 30 plus 40 plus 15, 45% it comes to. So this field was not there. So this field has been added to include this type of depreciation. So basically, if there is any purchase which is there, then depreciation, if it is claimed is 45%, then it has to be mentioned here in this clause. Then about details of investment, that is all deductions. If you see the time limit for extension, the time limit has been extended for investment in section 80, 80CC and all this chapter 6 deduction. So here now, if you have made any investment which is after 31st of March, here it is specifically given 30th June 2020 because now it has been extended to 31st July. So accordingly, the utility bill also changed. Here it is 1st April 2022, 31st July 2020 onwards. So any investment which is made after the subsequent date, this schedule is mandatory, is required to be filled up. So, and it has to be ensured that you don't claim this deduction again in assessment year 2021. Otherwise, it will be resulting in the wrong or incorrect information provided, and necessary penalties may be levied for giving the incorrect information. Section 80D, which relates to Mediclaim. Now here you are required to fill up additional details, because whatever is happening, that the deduction at the time of processing, if the amount which was exceeding the specified limit which was written in the software, which was enabled in the software, the Mediclaim premium which was paid was not being granted to the assessees. So here, this year, the part ATD part C for deduction and taxable income, the new schedule has been added. Wherein you will be required to ensure, give the additional information whether you or any of your family members, excluding parents, is a senior citizen. So first you will give whether any person in your family is a senior citizen, whether any of your parents is a senior citizen. If a senior citizen is saying, selecting it, he has yes, then you will have to give the details in the subheads like health insurance, preventive checkups, etc., etc., and the amount which is paid for senior citizen. Because based on this, the necessary deductions will be granted or at the time of processing of the returns. Then directorship details disclosure has been modified now. So earlier it was only that you have to give the information of the name of the company was required to be given. Now here you are required to give the selector of the company. Your person is a director in a listed or unlisted company. So that drop-down box was not available. So here the drop-down box has been provided. The PAN number of the company has to be given. And here you have to say that whether the type of the company, you have to give, select the type of the company, and you have to select it from the drop down box. And you have to inform here also whether the company is a listed or unlisted, with the director's DIN number has to be given, DIN number which is allotted by the MCA. So here it asks only for the company, it is not asking for LLP. So the LLP details are not required to be given. And if you are holding any unlisted equity shares at any time during the previous year, that previous year, then you are required to give this full chart has to be given. That is name of the company, type of the company. Again, here it has to be given closely held or this closely held company or the unlisted company or public company, etc. PAN number has to be given, opening balance, cost of acquisition, any transactions or sales done during the year, etc., etc. This all full schedule has to be prepared and to be filed in the return of income. Then schedule PDI is introduced this year. That is ITR 2 to ITR 7, wherein if you have any income under section 115 UA or 115 UB, that is basically related to REITs and other funds. So if any income which is received, because under section 115 UA and UB, that funds are being handled, the PAN number of the actual owner is given, and actual owners, if this income is taxable in the hands of the actual owner. So under which category of this, which category this income is taxable, that is house property, capital gains, if any pass-through income is there. So you have to give, fill up this schedule that this schedule relates to your income. This schedule is other, this part is relating to your fund, related respective fund, and aggregate income, which income is to be reported here. So either income or loss, what has to be there, it has to be reported here. So accordingly, the net income or loss will be computed. And whatever the TDS amount is deducted under this by the such type of fund, then that TDS amount also has to be reported here. So basically, this will be helpful at the time of processing of the return of income, that all information will be cross-linked and cross-verified. So be very specific in selecting or providing this information here. So here you will have to also select the drop down box, whether it is 115 UA or 115 UB, etc. Then you have to select from the drop down box. Then carry forward loss, the requirement here is extended. So here carry forward loss, basically if it is related to your pass through income or any to carry forward which is related to this income. So breakup has to be given here, whether it is normal or whether it is related to pass through income, and date of filing of the return of income here has to be given. So accordingly, this schedule will compute your information or automatically will compute your income which is chargeable to tax according to the information given in this system. Then new schedule E has been added, that is section E has been added in the computation of income. If any person who is adding income from this life insurance business, then they are required to fill up this schedule, wherein it requires that what is the net profit or loss from the life insurance business, which is referred to in section 115B. Additions, any in accordance, that is if any disallowances which is there from section 32, 43B, or any deductions which are there, accordingly the income from life insurance business will be computed. Under the computation of business of income, profession section F has been added for intra-head setup of loss or brought forward loss. The following points have been, that is under 115B, according to the same had been also been mentioned in the loss schedule. The necessary amendment has been done accordingly. Coming to ITR 6, that is ITR 6 now requires the income received in from foreign company as per section 115BD of the Income Tax Act, which is chargeable at a concession rate, should be reported in the separate field which has been given, that is in the schedule OS, that is other income in ITR 6. Schedule SH1 is not applicable in case of section 8 companies, that is reporting to share capital related kinds of company related, company and companies limited by guarantee, startups are exempted from the levy of this angel tax by this notification. So these type of companies are not required to give, fill up SH1 schedule, that is related to share, disclosure of share. Now, secondly, the verifier of the income tax returns in ITR 6 will have to mention the residential address of the person has to be given, and the DIN number of the person if it is signed by the director or any other person, director or the person who is authorized, if he is a director, is a CEO of the company or a key managerial personnel and he is having DIN, holding the DIN, then definitely the DIN number has to be given. So this mandatory field was not mandatory. Now this field is made mandatory here in the income tax return. So without this information, the returns cannot be uploaded. Then there is additional reporting in transfer pricing adjustment, that is relating to your transfer pricing. So any transfer pricing audit which has been done, and if any report is qualified or any addition is required to be made, a primary adjustment which is required to be made on which option 90 under section 92C2A is exercised, and such excess money has not been repatriated within the period, then you are liable for any additional tax. So this field has to be filled up with such type of activities and transactions are there, and you have to give the details of the taxes when it has been paid. ITR 7, there are lot many changes which are there. So in the basic information, 4 more declarations are now required to be given. That is, if any project is undertaken by the trust, then they are required to furnish that the name of the project has to be given, nature of activity, and any clarifications which are required to be reported, that has to be given. If any registered, because now you see that it's been made mandatory that all trust as required to be registered mandatory, the date has been extended to 1st of October. So all trust will be required to re-register their trust and obtain the number, which is to be done online. The necessary procedure will also be specified. So this type of information, if it is there, then they have to report such type of information here. Then details of the approval or registration under any other law under the Income Tax Act, that also has to be given, the name of the approving authority, approval number, etc., has to be given. So this field is basically mandatory. Whatever the sections where the registration you are holding under which you are granted the registration specifically, then you are required to report the income in that specified clause in ITR 7. Otherwise, it will compute the tax at the maximum marginal rate, and the demand notices are going to come. And this is the basic. Basically, we see most of the query reasons for issue of the default notice are in ITR 7. Many other people have got the notice by taxing the income at the maximum marginal rate because of the information which is not filled up correctly in the ITR. Even in many cases, it has been seen that though the information has been filled up correctly in ITR 7, the processing has not been done correctly. So in that case, if the processing, you have got the notices of demand, please follow up with raising the and follow up, then the same, the information has to be given. Donation with form part of the corpus, etc., the disclosure requirement is now enhanced, has to be given, so that disclosure is enhanced now. Other changes in the field, that is DTAA, income like interest, which is chargeable at the concessional rate on account of DTAA, then such reporting has residual income has to be reported in the special income clause. SI, schedule SI field has been added over there. Foreign companies reporting any royalty or 50s which are chargeable at a concessional rate, you have to report in the correct field. Otherwise, you will definitely get the short tax payment or demand notice. If the return is filed in response to the notice issued by the department, the UDN number is mandatory. Companies which are opting for alternate tax, that is, if you see the concessional rate of tax has been given, section 115BAA and 115BAB. Basically, if you are paying tax, you are selecting any, opting to select such type of scheme. At the general information field, you have to just select which section you are opting it for payment of tax. Accordingly, your tax liability will be computed by the system. Section 115B relating to the taxing of units of the mutual fund which are purchased in the foreign as offshore fund are chargeable at a concessional rate of 10%. Option to select SOP is added in ITR 5 and ITR 6 to report the property value as yield. Now, basically, what is happening that those this basically this field is for the builders and the developers who have already constructed the buildings and they have received the certificates, that is coming from this occupation certificate or the building certificate completion certificate has been received. So, if they have received the building's completion certificate and they are holding the property, the first 2 years they, I think they are exempt from paying any additional additional tax on the deemed let out property. So in that case, such type of property is there, such type of cases are there. So in ITR 5 and ITR 6, SOP has to be selected and reported this property, this type of property. So if you, after 2 years, notional rent has to be given as per the income from deemed let out property, whatever the provisions are there. So it has to be, tax has to be paid. So here you have to be, this year you have to ensure that if you are filing returns for any of the builders or developer which is there, so their projects have been completed, they are holding the property exceeding 2 years, then they have to report the income. Reporting of disallowance under section 14BA for AOP, there is a separate clause which was earlier, which was not available. That is basically related to the remuneration, etc., which is paid to the members of the association of persons. This was not allowed, so for them they have to separate field has been added in the ITR. Two points have been removed from the part B in ITR, that is corpus donation to other trust or institution which is chargeable as per the extension 2 and reduction under section 10AA. This has been removed, and new point has been added, that is net tax payable under section on 115TD income including interest, etc. So these basically are those who are working for the trust, they might be aware of what this income falls for, so they have to report it in the correct provisions. Then for claiming the refund, and for claiming the income tax refund, now you can give two bank accounts. That is, two bank accounts can be given. So if the first bank account is not working, the refund will be, can be transferred to the another bank account. So before mentioning here the account number, etc., you have to ensure that you pre-validate the bank account which is there on the income tax department's website. So first you pre-validate the bank accounts. So whatever the bank accounts which are pre-validated, two bank accounts can be pre-validated so that the refund comes in that account. So earlier minimum one account was in, now two accounts are there. And those, and in case of NRIs, those who don't have any bank account here in India, they can claim the refund in their foreign bank account. So if they want the bank refund in their foreign bank account, then they have to fill up this information. That is, they have to give the SWIFT code, name of the bank, country of the location, and IBAN number of the bank account in which they want to claim the want the refund to get. And if the number of rows which are at your bank account, you have more than one bank account, or then you can insert the additional field. The additional field option is also available. Then changes in the acknowledgement ITR file. Till last year, what was happening that when you were uploading the return of income, you were getting an acknowledgement, an unsigned acknowledgement which was there, and that an unsigned acknowledgement was required to be sent to the CPC Bangalore. Now here, instead of acknowledgement, it will now is now stated as Indian Income Tax Return Verification Form. It is now Indian Income Tax Return Verification Form. So this type of acknowledgement will be generated, wherein it won't have any details relating to your income. It will only have the SSA's name, PAN number, the return which is filed, which form number is filed, a acknowledgement number. The person has to do the signature here, and they have to send to the CPC Bangalore. And once the this acknowledgement is sent to the CPC Bangalore, they have received it, the final acknowledgement will be generated. This is the final acknowledgement. So if you compare the last year's acknowledgement and the current year's acknowledgement, there's a vast difference between the acknowledgement which is generated, because here it says that only gross total income deductions, etc., etc., was mentioned here. But now here it has been categorically divided. So here it says about details of income which is there, current year's losses, current year's income, because if your loss was there, then it was showing it as a zero in was coming here. So now it will have all these details. So whatever you are related to your tax, which is there, whatever you are related to your interest, etc., etc., this information here, this will be your final acknowledgement. Final acknowledgement. So once you have done the any verification, then this final acknowledgement is generated. Then you are not required to say send this acknowledgement to CPC Bangalore. Now what happens that suppose previously you have generated, you have filed the return without, and you have not completed e-verification proceedings. So even if you are not proceeded, if you have generated this, done this verification e-proceeding, e-verification is not done, you can do the e-verification subsequently within the specified time limit of 120 days. So then, and other modes of, even if you have not done the e-verification, at that time, the other modes also of e-verification are valid. You can do it to the, you are not required to mandatorily send that e-verification slip to the acknowledgement to CPC Bangalore. The net banking, through net banking, you can do it, through other OTP, you can do it, it can be done. But only ITR 6 requires the digital signature. With ITR 6 verification has to be done through digital signature. It cannot be done through other OTP or any other mode. Then there are validation and verification rules. So this has been made mandatory, or the last 3 years this has been made mandatory, but this year it has been made very strict. So any information which is mandatorily required to be given in the return, if it is not given, then your ITR XML will not be generated. Once the ITR XML is not generated, you will not be able to file. So there are three types of verification validation rules. That is, first is category A type of defect, wherein returns will not be allowed, to the XML will not be generated. So even if the XML is generated, when you try to upload it, system will not accept it, because it will show that the mandatory information is required to file the return is not been. So any validation error, such type of validation error is generated, please don't file the returns. Then second type of return is, that is, return data will be allowed to be uploaded, but the taxpayer uploading the return will be informed of the possible defect present in the return. That is, XML is generated, that we will give you a message that if you upload this type of return, then you will get the notices from the department, that 139(9) notices will come to you because of the defects which are found in the validation rules. So if both these type of errors, is error A and error B type of messages are there, please don't try to file or upload the return of income, because that will not be processed by the system. You will have to do the work again. So basically, when you are doing it, do it in a proper format so that you don't need to refile the returns. And third party utility errors. Now basically, if you see most of the people are using the private software and they are not using the department software. Almost around, I think statistical information says that almost around 85% returns are being prepared by using the third party utility provider software. So software, various softwares are available. There is not mandated that you have to use the software, but when you are using the software, certain informations are captured automatically by the system itself. But at the time of processing of the return of income, if the department finds out that there are these certain software providers, utilities are giving certain type of errors, then they will be alerted that these errors are there in your software. Kindly improve your software quality. Otherwise, your license will be cancelled, because without obtaining taking the license, whenever the third party utility provider software is being the utility is generated through this third party utility provider software, they are given a unique code. That unique code appears in the ITR XML, and based on that, the information is being captured by the department that where, how exactly, which type of software providers most errors are being happening. So in this type of error, that software providers will be alerted, and if the this type of mistakes continue, then their license will be cancelled and they won't be given any serial number to upload the future returns of income. Basically, the reasons for calculating missed income is that whatever the mandated income is there is required to be filled up. Whenever you are selecting any income or you are reporting any income, please report it in the correct law, in the correct field, so that there are no mistakes. Computation of income, what is happening? The mistakes are happening because of the two reasons. Because the accurate and the complete filling up of the relevant column or detail in the income tax return is most crucial for correct calculation of income. So basically, when you have filled up full ITR, and when you validate it file, and when you compute your tax, there is a option which is there in the ITR, utility compute the tax. So in computation of your tax, you just verify whether whatever tax figures you have computed, whether that is correct, whether the return refund which is computed, whether it is correct or not. If you find any mistakes which are there, then basically just verify the computations before uploading the return of income. So it will give you the idea as to where this mistake has happened. There may be certain mistakes from our side also, because we may not be aware of the provisions which have been amended, or we may be referring it to some other old provisions. Chances are being better, chances are there. So basically, whenever the ITR returns are filled up, or if there any computation which is generated, when you compute on this generated tax liability, actually it is 143-1A which is generated by the system. So that 143-1A is automatically available to the system, to you. So verify it, and before uploading the return, accuracy of this has to be ensured, that so that you don't need to work it again, or you don't need to file the revised return again. Most of the time, the department's utility are now 99.99% correct. There are no mistakes in the utility. There may be some mistakes, but if you find out or come across to such mistakes, definitely you can report to this, so that when the next version is released, definitely they will take care of such mistakes which are there in the utility. In case the computation of income or refund is different from what has been entered or what is expected, please verify the accuracy of the data which is entered in the ITR. Checkpoints are there, basically the total salary from all employees. Now you see the form TDS returns, that is form number 24Q, has been amended. So in form number 24Q, now we are required to give the information of all the taxpayers. So this all information will be available in 26AS. So here you have to ensure that whatever income which is reported in form number 16, the same income should be reported here in ITR 1 or 4 or a scheduled salary in any other ITR. So basically, if there is a mistake in the form in form number 16, please get the form number 16 corrected first. Otherwise, your system is going to take the figure which is there in reported in form 16, not what you reported in the return of income. If your return of income income is reported higher figure, or a form number 16 which reports higher figure, so any higher figure of the figure will be taken by the system for computing. Interest income on fixed deposit, savings bank account, etc. should be entered in the separate column, because savings bank interest, again, when you enter any amount in savings bank account interest, automatically it will trigger to section 80T deduction, that is which is available under chapter 6. So if you report the income aggregately in any one of the clause, then definitely this is going to create a problem in at the time of processing of the return. Late filing, because late fee is there, 271, enough time is there, that is penal interest of 234A, that is again subject to this, losses cannot be carried forward, reduction under section 88, this related to chapter 6 part B is not allowed. Basically everybody is aware of this. Then you have various mechanisms for e-verification, that is for e-verification return, that is through net banking. So if you want to verify your return to net banking, first you have to ensure that your bank account has been pre-validated. So bank account can be pre-validated if your bank account is linked with the PAN number. Now, if in many cases it has been found that the bank account is not linked with the PAN number, there are three or four reasons why this bank account cannot be linked with the PAN number. So first of all, the first basic reason here is you have to provide the bank PAN number to the bankers. And when you provide the bank PAN number to the bankers, you have to ensure that the name, what is written on the PAN number, what is there in the income tax report, has to match with the bank account name with the bank account. Otherwise, your bank account won't get linked. So this is the mandatory criteria. So if your account is pre-validated, then you can do the net banking through this net banking facility. You can verify your return. You can verify through this bank account number, that is ITD portal. Your cell number has to be registered. That is mandatory. Even you can re-validate your this verification can be done through your DMAT account. But then also the option of DMAT account also pre-validation is required. Your cell number has to be registered. Through registered email ID and mobile number can be done over through this is this is option is only available if your income is less than 5 lakhs or your refund is less than or equal to 100, then only is to this option is available. For other SSC it is not available. And through Aadhaar OTP, if the Aadhaar is linked through the ITD portal and also your Aadhaar has the mobile number registered. If your Aadhaar is not registered with the mobile number, you have to get the Aadhaar updated through the from the Aadhaar center, and then only you can do through Aadhaar. Password for login is now, this is the changes which are going to happen, that is password for login on ITD portal to be replaced with the Aadhaar OTP. So to prevent the misuse. So whenever you want to log in, your login will be directly with your Aadhaar OTP. So once you put the PAN number, it will directly take you to the OTP will come to the SSC, and you will be able to log in. So your password is going to be done away with in the next few years. Then locking of the PAN for unauthorized use. So basically, if you insert your incorrect password for more than 3 times, then secondly your PAN will be locked for 24 hours. That is what is happening in TDS returns also. Expanding the capturing of information from earlier in returns to prefill option. The department is planning to give you a prefill utility with whatever the information it is available. Based on your last year's details, based on your 26 years, the prefill utility will be provided. So you will have to just verify whether these details are correct or not. The option will be available to you to modify it, to correct it. So if any information is available in your prefill utility, and if you see that information is incorrect, basically get that information corrected, previous or corrected from the person, and then only you file the return. Otherwise, this information which is available in Form 26F or in AIR information, now what it's stated is, it will be your assessment will be computed based on that, and based on this information, your other purpose that is related to your selection or scrutiny will be done. Validation of bank account before filing of the return instead to get the refund credited without the delay, that is we already discussed about it, that pre-validation has to be done. Real-time processing of returns, that is once you upload the returns, basically this will is going to start, this is basically for ITR 1 and ITR 4. Once you have uploaded, immediately your returns will be processed through the system, that is what is under process. So real-time processing of returns, immediately you will get the assessment order. So these are the basically the new changes which are proposed by the department. Don't wait for the last day, because last days is very critical. And I have got a beautiful meme. This is that basically we are relying on our staff to file the returns, and when the staff reports if file the returns ITR of a company by uploading any other company's balance sheet, this is what can happen. So please see that any information which is uploaded on the figure, if it is incorrect, definitely you may not get the chance. The 26 AS is now, that is replaced with annual information statement, that is CBDT has notified by notification number 30. And the CBDT, this will be effective from 1st June onwards. But now the new form 26 AS has not yet come, because till the DDS, TDS data returns filing date has been extended. So this returns now annual information consists of two parts. That is part A and part B. Part B will have these two additional information. That is, Aadhaar number will come if your PAN is linked with Aadhaar. Then date of incorporation, date of birth will come, mobile number will come, email address will come, your address will come. So any of this information, if you want to correct it, then you have to file this form number 49A to correct this information. Then only this real information will be corrected. So form number 49A basically is related to changing the such information. So if this information is correct, you can change it through filing form number 49A. Second part B, this is basically will be giving the information, that is seven informations will be given to you, that is related to your tax deducted and collected at source. Then any specified transaction, financial transaction you have entered, that is purchase of property or purchase of any this SFT statement, that is Section 285B related to the 13 classes, deposit of cash in bank account, purchase of shares, investment in shares, etc. Then information relating to your payment of taxes, that is payment of any advance tax, self-assessment tax, etc. Information relating your demand and refund, that is what is your demand which is outstanding on the income tax portal, or what is your refund application which is pending, that also will be there in AIR. Then about your pending assessment proceedings will also be there. And then what is the information relating to your completed processings, any information other than sub-rule relation to this, all information will be available. So this will give you a rough idea what has to be captured, what type of information has to be there. So while filing the return of income, you have to ensure that all this information is taken into account, because all these informations are provided to you well in advance before the filing of return of income. So don't be in a hurry this year to file the return of income, because whenever all this information is updated, definitely then you file the return of income, because that this is going to any mismatch of income is going mismatch of reporting of information is resulting in will result in scrutiny notices, etc. Secondly, if any information is incorrect which is found in this part B, then you are required to ensure that you get it rectified from the related you contact to the related department. And also, if any information relating to here is incorrect, you can definitely raise an ED warrant. ED warrant facility is there. You can report to your assessing officer that there is this information which is found, which is incorrect. When you raise the ED warrant, definitely this information is captured by CPC IPR and CPC TDS. So there is an option in ED warrant that where you want to file it. Any information which is related to your TDS or related to your tax deduction or tax collection, you have to report it to the TCS. If any information which is relating to your pending proceedings, then you have to approach to the assessing officer or CPC. So accordingly, you use this ED warrant facility. Even after using this ED warrant facility, if your grievances are not getting corrected, then there is the option which is available. You can file a CPGRAM. That is, CPGRAM is available on pgportal.gov.in. That is the option available. And basically, it should be ensured that it should be a last resort to raise such type of grievance, because that is handled centrally by the Finance Ministry. Then this is the notification, latest notification, that is the due date which has been revised, that is income tax returns for financial year 18-19, 30th June has become 31st of July, then a 30th November furnishing tax audit report 31st October, then self-assessment tax, that is 30th November, if up to 1 lakh there will be no interest on 234A. So TDS statements again 15th 1920, government deductor 15 July, TDS returns 31st of July, issue of TDS certificate 15 days, passing of order on the 31st March, that is linking Aadhaar and etc. I think this is available, everybody is aware of it. So useful tip, don't directly returns are generally prepared by the staff and uploaded to ensure that it is correct before uploading, because before uploading, it is our responsibility. Ultimately, the person who is filing the return becomes accountable. Then ensure that the sufficient and accurate backup is available for future requirement, because what is happening here that we are working and working, and know that whenever the system will get crash or something will happen, because now we are in such a situation. Since last at least 10-15 days, we are aware that we are getting sufficient messages, that we have enough messages that there's going to be a hacking of the software system. So don't blindly rely on the software or the software system. Ensure that sufficient backup is available for future requirement. Even cloud is also risky. So even if you have the data on the cloud, ensure that you have a sufficient backup which is not available in your office. Don't keep one. You have to keep one backup which is at a separate place, not in the office, because something happens to the office and the backup is not available, then it will create a problem. So basically, the viruses are such that they may hang up your system. Delete the unwanted workings from time to time to ensure that whenever your balance sheet is finalized, whenever your audit report is finalized, or whenever your return is finalized, what is your final return or final workings are there, keep only that working. Remove other unwarranted working and basically remove it from the system so that basically it does not hamper your RAM or your processing of the returns. The return processing becomes very much slow. Then returns from the private software should not be blindly considered as accurate and final. Though many software providers are there, basically their returns are too much final, but definitely validation of the utilities of the income tax departments are more or less control oriented. And we have seen that many software engineers are there. There is software chartered accountants are there who are very much aware, very much finding it easily to modify the utilities which are generated by the system. Please don't do that, because your processing is being done by the system. Whatever is written in the software, ITBA does the processing, and whatever the information which is captured from the utility, it will be processed by the system and it will be processed by the act. Even if you modify or give incorrect information, modify the utility, the controls which are there in the system is going to take the figures from there and is going to give you the default notices. This is basically relating to provisions relating to assessment, that is no adjustment under 143(1) on account of mismatch between form 26AS. There will be a warning which will be generated that your information is not matching with form 26AS. No deduction of expenses even if unexplained income is determined by the assessment officer. So this is a very serious. So if you have any income which is found as which is not reported in the return of income, but you will be having the expenses against such income, then that expenses may not be allowed. So be very specific while reporting in the return of income. So chartered accountants, again, this is also a big problem for us also, that basically the department can file a complaint against chartered accountants for mistakes if they are found out in the reports or anything. So be very specific while filing. But the option is available to the chartered accountants or any other which is part, they can approach to the ITAT files. E-proceedings is extended to all the scrutiny assessments now. Higher penalty for default in furnishing the EIR information. Section 80AC has been introduced to extend the disallowance of the deduction of section 80AS to the RRB if the return is not filed within the due date. So specified. So when you are claiming any deductions under this section, see that the return is filed in time. Prosecutions are there for not filing of the ICR but the IDR in time. Then provide the imprisonment up to 2 years if the person does not file the return of income after giving the notice. Exemption is given if the return is furnished till the end of the assessment year or if the tax payable is up to ₹3,000, but companies are excluded from that. The basic reason here is to prevent the abuse of the exemption which is provided on the basis of the amount of tax payable by the shell companies or by the companies holding the Benami properties. So any help if it is required, you have the call center numbers. Now the call centers are not working at present due to COVID, but definitely you can call the call centers numbers. You can send the mail to the e-filing help desk and your queries, any queries are there. And ITD tools are available, there's help menu are available. All the presentations are available on the return. Any type of services you require on the ITD website, all help menus are available. You can download the presentations from there and the step-by-step guidelines are there. You can take the benefit of that. These are the call center, dedicated call center numbers. That is for e-filing of returns. Any query related to e-filing of returns, then you can call on this cell number. Any query related to other income tax queries, the cell dedicated call center numbers are there. Future is definitely new utilities are going to come. Changes are going to happen. And these are the self-assessments now, if verified properly. So if you verify this return of income properly, you are not going to get any such type of default notices from the department, provided you give the information correctly. But future is e-assessment is definitely there. E-assessment is not going to the e-assessment is the future. It is started and it is not going to stop. So virtual meeting is going to be virtual. Assessment is going to start for all this type of cases. So be aware that you don't have, earlier you had the option that you were went to the assessing officer and where you had the option to explain the details cases to us. But now it will be restricted and it will be limited to certain extent. Though there is a options are there. You can go for this virtual hearing, but at the time of virtual hearing, also specific time limit, specific documents will be required to be submitted. So any information which is given should be conditions would be in 26 AM. Any information which is there in 26 AS needs to be correctly analyzed and reported in the return of income. So return, this is the main tool which is what is selection of scrutiny. Income tax department, CPC, is the data center of all the information. All the information will be preserved for the lifetime. It cannot be taken out from the system unless and until the system is hacked or something happens, the server gets hanged or whatever, server gets corrupted. But it will be preserved for the lifetime. The entire information, whether we will be there or not in the future, we don't know, but definitely the information will be available. So, friends, I have tried to cover maximum things which were there in the ITR. Something you might have liked it, some things you might have not liked it, but this is the future and you have to be with it. I have tried my level best that you cannot do the today's job with yesterday's methods for the tomorrow's business. Because when you want to do the today's job, then you have to do with the today's working only and today's methods only. Not yesterday's method is not going to work, or the tomorrow's business cannot be done with the yesterday's same. So mistake, if it is a mistake, kindly accept the mistake and let us correct it in time so we don't get such type of notice. So if any questions are there, any doubts are there, and this is purely my views, what I have understood. So there may be certain mistakes or certain things are there. So if there are any corrections or something I have missed out, you can definitely point it out so that at least it will be helpful for others, that the others can also take the benefit of it. And I'm definitely thankful to everybody for your patience hearing, and we can take the queries now.
Avinash bhai, thank you for the
Now.
presentation.
Now.
We
There
have
are certain
certain questions,
questions,
so
so
I'll
I
just ask you.
yeah.
One member, any limit for rent income to mention PAN number or Aadhaar number of the tenant?
I think 1 lakh rupees is the limit which is there. As per the act, it is 1 lakh limit. 1 lakh limit is there.
Yes. Capital gain will also form part of 26 AS. As you mentioned, all AIR information are there in 26 AS.
Right.
So will this also form part of 26 AS?
No, capital gains is not going to form a part of them, because they may come, because what is department, when lastly when we had spoken that they are going to provide with the pre-filled utility, let us see now what they are providing it. You have to wait and watch. It may come away, because basically SFT transactions are there. The SFT transactions also covers this type of, so any purchases exceeding 10 lakhs may come in that, because SFT requires that type of reporting. And let us see how this new form 26A comes and what information is provided.
You already answered, but there's one question. Is validation of all bank accounts mandatory, or any bank can be validated?
See, basically you can validate, basically if you validate all the bank account, it is good. But basically what means, then it will give you the option to e-verify the returns to all the bank accounts. But basically two bank accounts are recommended to be pre-validated, because but in the ITR you have to give all the bank accounts, even though it is pre-validated or not. So while filling the ITR, you have to give all the bank accounts, but for pre-validating minimum two, at least it is one is required, but basically I would recommend that you give more than one. Because sometimes the bank server, that bank server may not be working properly, so you get the option, other option which is there.
Then there was one question. Can the information in pre-filled return be changed?
Yeah, definitely. It will be allowed to change. But see that whenever the pre-fill information which is given, it has to be ensured that it is correct or not. But while changing, it is also becoming risky, because at the time of processing, it may take that information only. So you get that information corrected before reporting in the return of income. I would advise that.
Now I'll request members, if you have any question, you can just raise your hands. या विजय भाई,
Avinash bhai, I have
हाँ
a question for you.
या
You said that while filing the return, there is a place for whether the return is filed under 7th provision to section 139(1).
राइट
There you said that if someone is a regular IT return filer, he need not mention anything and it is not applicable. That has to be mentioned. But Well, even if the someone is a regular IT return filer, in my view, the burden of filing under 139(1) has to be tested every year. So if one has income below taxable limit and no criteria is fulfilled to file the return, he can mention both no, that I'm not supposed to file the return under 139(1), neither I'm supposed to file under 7th provision also. Can he mention that like that?
Yes, he can mention that.
Huh. So in case I'm not supposed to file the return, I can put both the no tick over there.
Yes.
I'm not filed to return. Huh. Otherwise, it will be treated other, you know, differently by the department.
No. If you are not required to file because of this also, and you are filing it voluntarily, you can select no over there. You can file the return. No problem.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, Aman bhai. You need to unmute, Aman bhai.
I did it. Okay, fine. Thank you, Avinash ji, for your excellent propositions for the subject and also conveners. My question is, can ITR be uploaded without paying the self-assessment tax?
Yes.
So, it will be then...
Then 15 days time limit will be given to you to pay the tax, and again you will have to file this revised return, because what will happen that it will, the demand will not be removed from the system. So basically, if you have the time limit which is there for paying the taxes, first pay the taxes and then file the return. Otherwise, after 15 days, that way, if the notices are issued within 15 days, you will have to file the return. Otherwise, you will be treated as invalid return.
2020 is for those assessee who could not file the return for almost 15 months, and they may not be able to file the return because of the non-availability of the funds to pay the tax. So we can advise them. So
now the time limit is there. It's 1st of July, you can file it, no?
No, that's true. But we can always advise them that you file the return by 31st July and again wait for 15 days or the another notice of 139. At least you are having the return being filed.
Yes.
That's what I'm showing an additional time availability.
Yes, you can do it.
You can take a chance.
Yes, definitely.
Because how fast the department will issue 139(9) notice is also a subject matter of debate.
Yes.
So that will take time. That will take time.
You can do it. No problem.
Okay. Thank you.
I think two more queries are there. I will take it up. That is, can you explain the requirement of UDI and ITR? It is basically the UDI and the notices which has come in the return. That is because when you have received a notice to file the return of income, then UDI will be generated. At that time, you are required to mention in the return. Otherwise, it is not required, because when you are not filed the return and a notice has come, that notice, in case you are filing in response to any notice, then you have to mention it in the return of income. For login into IT website, whether other OTP will become password? Yes, it is going to become, but it is not mandated till yet. What happens if the mobile number is not registered on Aadhaar? Basically, you will have to get this updated. Aadhaar needs to be updated with the mobile number. That is the thing, because then it will become very difficult. Regular SSE need not fill up and is filing returns. Okay, in the case of NRI, it is not compulsory to be. So in NRI case, Aadhaar number is not mandatorily required to be given. So they can use their regular user ID and password. So then they can be done.
Harish bhai?
Yes. Yeah. Can I go ahead with my question?
Yeah, please.
Yeah. For 44AB, optional limit of 1 crore to 5 crore, gross receipts in cash of 5%, how do you calculate? What do you do with the contra transaction, especially as a bank fixed deposit? If there is maturity of bank fixed deposit, would you consider that as fresh receipt? Or what would you do?
Basically, I think it should not, because that is related to cash and bank. It is not the third. Basically, it is related to third party transaction. It is an internal transaction. So it not, from my opinion, it should not come according to me.
Okay. For example, suppose there is investment and there is investment maturity which is taken to current account or OD account. Will be treated as fresh receipts?
That is to bank account.
Yeah. So it means that will be considered
as related to, that is not related to cash. Basically, they want to see that your cash inflow or outflow should be less than 5%.
Yeah, so how do you calculate, if you have to calculate 5%, you have so to go add bank.
Go to the gross receipts definition which is given in section 44AB of the Income Tax Act.
Yeah, so cash and bank both will have to be added, isn't it?
Basically the guidance note is issued by the institute. Even in the guidance note, the definition of the gross receipt is definitely given in that. Kindly refer to that. It will give you more clarifications over there.
Oh, okay. Well, thank you.
Yeah. There is a revised guidance note which is available. It is available for free download on the Income Institute website. You can download it. Both the guidance notes are available. Revised Form 3CP guidance note and institute guidance note. And also the BCA has also come up with a publication relating to this this matter. So you can refer to the BCA publication also. That will be also much more helpful.
Sir, the question was which I asked you was relating to if the gross receipt increases, that 5% limit increases.
Definitely.
For cash. That's why in that connection I was asking that suppose there is an investment in say shares and the money is realized, whether that will be treated as gross receipts for the purpose of calculation of 5%.
Investment in shares which is there, that income is basically the gross receipts which has come. That is why you have to see the gross receipts definition. Basically it was, you have to analyze based on that, because on case to case basis you have to work it out.
Correct. If suppose loan is taken as gross receipts, capital introduction is taken as gross receipt, then investment is also gross receipt. Investment realization is also gross receipt. Bank fixed deposit is actually, what you do is you remove from the bank account, you show it as fixed deposit as a separate head. So if that is realized, I in my view, sir, I'm trying to understand from you, sir, that 5% limit automatically gets increased because of that bank fixed deposit.
That is basically in the ITR what they have given, the basically 3 or 4% things they have given in the ITR. That is loan, capital contribution and all. That has to be worked out. See, if you see the ITR, in the ITR 139, this the 44AB what they have mentioned, that these things has to be computed for computing this.
Okay, right. Thank you, sir.
Avinash Bhai, Manish Mehta here.
Yeah.
The presentation is very excellent.
Thank you.
Okay. So now what I have to ask you, in case of NRI, it is not compulsory to have the Aadhaar number.
Right.
So now for login, you are saying Aadhaar OTP is required. So how the NRI can now login?
No, that is basically they are going to make it with Aadhaar OTP if you are registered on the Aadhaar, otherwise not.
Yeah, but it is not compulsory for NRI. No,
there will be other options also. Will be there. Don't worry about it.
Okay.
It is under consideration. See, linking of Aadhaar is under consideration since last 3 years. They have not yet implemented.
Now it is until December. They had extended.
But that will again extend it to March. Don't worry.
Okay. Yeah, Harish Arora ji.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Janam, and thanks, Avinash Bhai. Very good to interact on this platform. Congrats to all. Manish had also discussed on the same, that we being chartered accountants file the returns for many clients. So if Aadhaar OTPs have to be taken every now and then, it would be cumbersome for the clients also.
Definitely, sir. Basically, what say the departments, the income tax says that chartered accountants are not authorized to file the return. It is the SSC who has to file the return.
So some other activity we should be doing.
The income tax website, last 15 days back, there was a message on the income tax that you don't have to visit to the chartered accountant to file the return of income.
Great.
Return of income will be filed by SSC without any help from the chartered accountant.
Fantastic. So,
this is what is happening.
Thanks. But I'm sure our WIT also would be taking a representation route for this if at all this is done. But you said it will. It is proposed, not yet.
It is proposed that it is there under consideration that they want to do it. Basically, to make it fully secure, because what is happening, the passwords and all, it is getting. Because what is happening, many SSCs whose returns are being filed, they are not aware what is going on, the notices which are coming, because due to some or other reasons, this problem which has been faced by at least 2-3% type of returns are there, wherein the SSCs are not aware that their returns are being filed and everything has been done. And because of this, they might have, that is one of what my thinking goes in.
And of course, security reasons also.
Correct. So because of this, they want to do that. SEC should be aware that there somebody has logged in on the website on his VM.
Fine. Vasant Kothari ji, you can raise your question.
Yeah, yeah. Sir, my question is only in respect of the NRI, who has bank account attachment with the PAN number. They are not having the Indian mobile number. And CPC asked for the Indian mobile number.
Authorized representative's PAN number. No? Authorized representative can be added and can be given for such cases.
We are not getting the refund.
Okay, chalo. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Dinesh Shivariji, you can raise your question.
Avinash bhai, yeah. You said that for this builder's case, when you file the return, that 2 years SOP they can show, and that has to be properly filled up. Now, say if in the current year, March 20, the 2 year period is getting over in December, so you will calculate deemed LOP rent for 3 months only. How will it work?
That is a tricky question, basically, because two years period, I think you have to see the exactly, read the provisions, when exactly it is getting, how it is going to
work. No, I'm saying no, because say, for example, that 2 years, the day completion certificate was received on 31st of December 18, okay. 31st of December 20, Your 19, that 2 year period is getting over, say for example. So now what is happening is you are filing your return for March 20.
Okay.
December 19, your 2 year period got over.
Yeah.
So you will file.
From my view, you have to take it for three months only, that rented property. The rent you have to declare it for 3 months.
That it will accept.
Whatever figures you mentioned over there, it is accepted. It doesn't go and verify whether that property is actually giving that much rent or not. There is no such cross verification over there.
Okay. No, because it is a DLOP, that's why. There is no question of actual rent being sent.
You have to refer to section 22 to 24, whatever is related to the property accordingly.
Adi Shivji, you can ask your question.
Hello, yeah. Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, okay.
There's a peculiar thing, you know, I have got one NRI client and they have got an NRO account also, which is pre-validated, but the refund is not going through so many times. Means we tried in two banks, but it is not going through. So now she has opened up a third account in SBI and maybe we'll try with that. But I don't know why it's not going through. Can you help me out on that, please?
I'm facing for my case is this problem since last 5 years.
Okay. So we are all
basically I'll tell you the in that you write it to the CPC. The case is with CPC or it is with assessing officer?
No, it's with the CPC. That is the problem. They are not transferring.
What you do is you just delete that account and pre-validate it again.
Okay.
And then you raise an e-warrant with SBI and treating an SBI refund banker. And raise the e-warrant to SBI refund banker. It will take within 15 days, you will get the refund.
Okay, let's try that. Thank you.
Just try, because this trial and error are there. Everybody, we all...
we're doing since last 1.5 years, but we're not...
I'm facing this problem since last 5 years. My refund has been after meeting CPC for so many years.
Okay. Thank you.
Avinash, there's one question. NRI not having Indian mobile number for validation is an issue. How to address?
Authorized representative, you can give it. You can make somebody as an authorized representative, you can give it. Fine.
All yes. Sir, just one question from Vijay Bhai. So, final. Vijay Bhai.
It is not a question. It is some addendum to the earlier replies was given by Avani. One of our member had a problem with the how the mobile number can be given, and Avinashji suggested that authorized representative to be appointed. I think that is a very good route. If there is a power of attorney or a letter of authority given to a local person, then at a time 1 year, one can be assigned the local one as an authorized representative, and everything will flow from the authorized representative. Even the return filing, everything will be done by authorized representative.
If any fraud is committed by that person, again, that will also come into the authorized representative.
Yes, 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 yes. But it can be done only when among the family members.
Yes, yes.
Letter of authority is required to be uploaded while accepting that authorized
representative. You have to add, there is an add authorized representative option in the income.
Yes, there is an option. And we can do it. I have been doing it for all my NRI clients.
Yes,
so the local people are all signing the ITRB and everything.
If you are comfortable with that person, you can definitely do that.
Yes, yes, yes. And there is a proper letter of authority which is given, which is notarized and everything.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I would also suggest that while filing the return of income now from this year, at least basically take a representation letter from all the SSEs. They're clarifying all these details relating to the transactions done, banks and all, because tomorrow if some bank accounts or anything has been missed out, you may let us inform. That is one of my suggestions also to everybody.
Yeah.
That should be done. And you should definitely, what should be done, that even your IP address is being tracked from where the return is being uploaded. So basically you should prepare the IP. XML should be prepared and given to the SSE, let him only file the return. So tomorrow anything happens, so you can be held responsible.
Don't make that mistake that client should file the return, because they will know how to file it and they will devalue our work. So better is that you take a remote control of that client's desktop and then do it.
You can use any desk.
If you want. Huh?
You can use any desk and get the upload there.
That is what I'm saying. Yes. But I think that is not a very remote possibility. We can file the return with the two letter of authority.
Many cases are there. I'm dealing with all these things since last 14, 15 years. I have come across too many such things which I cannot discuss on this platform. Or
Thank you very much, Avinash.
Thank you very much.
Vasant bhai.
Haji. Sir, on the same issue again, that NRI refund, because the we have already given the number of representative in the CPC, ITR apna PAN record. But the bank, you see, we have to give our representative number is very difficult for the NRI, because then all informations will of the NRI's transactions will come to the authorized representative account, and he may
authorize. Basically, bank account, you have to give the details of the person, the details of the NRI, that NRI SSO. You don't have to give the details related to the authorized representative's bank details.
No, only mobile number of the authorized representative, because bank mobile number which match with the authorized representative number given in the
mobile number has no relevance with this bank account details, etc., because it doesn't have any password or nothing comes on the related to your bank details on the mobile number.
When we are attaching with the bank account with the PAN number, it is a mandatory that 10 digit mobile number is required to be given.
Hello.
The bank
account is also available for you.
Yeah, rightly, but bank account attachment is, I think, required. Reissue required also doesn't go.
Refund bank account number, because then you have to find out some other option related to that. How it can work? Because it is a
pattern. I tried to the. I called the CPC as well as ICAR Sampar Kendra, but they are also not able to reply.
Yeah, they will not be able to answer you.
Yeah, they are not able to do it. Thank you.
Yeah.
Last question. The last question.
Yes, sir, no problem.
Hi. Can I, Aminash ji?
Yes, please.
Now the simple question is, the SSE has filed a return of income, uploaded the return of income for 31st March 19 already, but that return is yet not verified. The time limit for verifying that return has already passed, 120 days has passed. Now, since the date is extended, he can still file the return before 31st July 20, for the assessment year 1920. Can he do that? Because that return is invalid and still on the website as a uploaded return yet to be verified, but now become invalid.
You can file it, no problem.
Return is already uploaded. Return is already uploaded earlier.
Return is already uploaded. That is not accepted in the system. So once it is not accepted, you raise a re-demand to remove that return of income, and you can file the fresh return.
So can I? What I was planning was that I will upload the new return as original return is already there in the system, which is invalid. So this will be a original return or it will be a revised return first?
Yes, it has to be a original return only because that is not considered return.
But that return is not at all existing. Therefore, a original return has to be filed.
Yes.
So if we file and then some message is coming on the system, then it is okay. Otherwise, we'll have to forget about it.
Yes.
We have to try only.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you, members, for attending this virtual meeting. We'll have 2-3 more meetings in the month of July. Now, I'd like to thank Avinash Bhai for the detailed discussion on the key changes in the income tax returns and return filing. He has been very kind enough to accept the invitation on a very short notice and deliver such a good topic. Only a person of his caliber can do that, because, you know, he's every day into income tax and everything. I think everybody's receiving his WhatsApp messages with the key changes and everything. So thank you very much, Avinash Bhai, for delivering such a good lecture for the benefit of the members. And members, thank you for attending the meeting. And I will also like to thank Ankit Sanghvi for arranging all this, the Zoom meeting platform, and you know, we can be here on the virtual platform and attend the good meeting. So thank you, Ankit. Thank you, Avinash Bhai.
Thank you very much. Thank you,
all of them. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, members.